Good morning, friends. In today's lecture, we will progress our marketing research area. In this lecture, we will decide to how to design a questionnaire, how to better design a questionnaire, and briefly explain what are the issues when we design a questionnaire. Now, first we decide, in general, description of a questionnaire. What is a questionnaire? Now, a questionnaire is generally used as a tool for survey. Okay, it is a kind of method by which we can conduct a survey. We can also conduct an interview, which is a kind of structured interview. So when we conduct a structured interview, questionnaire can be a tool. So it is a kind of conducting structured interview. Okay. Now when we see about the structured interview, it means it follows a structure of certain set of questions which are written in a sequence which we ask towards the respondent to get some information. So from this background, if we describe or if we define the questionnaire, then the questionnaire is a set of questions. Okay. A set of structured questions make up in a sequence through which we can gather the information from the respondent on our desired object. If we move on to the what are the different types, what are the different methods through which we can gather information or perception or satisfaction or whatever my research objective, based on the research objective, what are the different methods through which we get the information, we can classify this questionnaire methods into basically three types. Mail questionnaires through mailing. Now today mail has been quite replaced with emails. So it is a method through which we circulate an email, give the form, a Google form or Google email, through which the respondent will fill the electronic form. Email or through Google forms, it is the most popular method of circulating the questionnaires or conducting an interview, conducting a questionnaire data collection. Second is telephonic. So through telephone or through mobile phones, we can conduct a survey through which the researchers call the respondent and ask certain questions, and based on the answers given by the respondent, they tick the appropriate column or appropriate values in this in their structured questionnaire. So telephonic is another method through telephones or through mobile phones. It is quite easy to conduct. It's location independent, it's time independent. Another most popular is personal. A personal interview method in which the respondent is being contacted by the researcher in person. They conduct a personal interview, a personal interaction, and through that personal interaction, they fill out the forms and take out the appropriate values in the person. So basically, these are the three methods: mails, telephonic, and personal interview. When we describe the process of designing a questionnaire or conducting a survey through a questionnaire or data collection through a questionnaire, then process certainly have some steps. Now, if we divide the whole process or whole thing into certain steps, first and most foremost important step is decide on information component. And through which, in this step, we decide upon what are the basic business or customer information we want to capture. what are the information components we want to capture, to collect in a questionnaire. Suppose for a demographic detail, what type of question we have to ask. Suppose for a geographic detail, we have to ask for location based questions. We have to ask for a gender based, or for a demographic detail like age, gender. For family status, we have to ask family, number of family members, marital status. Occupational wise, then what are the different occupations, then what are the income level of the respondent. So basically from that point of view, we can decide what are the information component. Based on that information component, we design certain set of questions. So second step is question design. Then we design certain questions. If it is in based on the English language, then we decide on what certain English languages or English language question, convert that question into an English language or a local language, or maybe the language in which the respondent is preferred. Then we decide the question structure. So question designing is the most important part. It consists of certain sub points, we can say. It decides on three basic parts. The question content itself. Then inability or unwillingness of the respondent to respond to the questionnaire, to the desired, what is the required question. And the third is how you structure your questionnaire. Okay. So basically, when designing a questionnaire, we have to first what the content you want to ask, what is the structure you want to follow, and then how this content and structure will combinedly affect or the overcome the inability of the respondent or unwillingness of the respondent to respond to us. Because at the last, the basic objective of a good questionnaire design is to motivate the respondent to respond. So the your best questionnaire design will be, can be a glossy if is the respondent are of that nature. It can be encompass some technical issues. It can include some chart, figures, pictures, etc. Depends on the type of the respondent you are getting, and depends on the type of responses and the interest the respondent is making in your response in the question. Okay, so we come to cover this one by one, and then we will move forward toward the presentation in which more details are presented. When we decide on the content, for example, when I decide or when we ask a question which contains two possible questions and two possible answers. Suppose when I ask a question like, suppose I ask for the Dairy Milk, the chocolate is tasty and refreshing. So if I ask this statement, ask the agreement or disagreement level of the respondent on this particular statement, then there is a flaw in this statement itself or this question itself. What? You are trying to combine two different aspects or two different attributes of a product into a single question, and it may create a confusion to the respondent. How? Because you are asking about this taste feature and this refreshing characteristic of a product in a single question. So it can create an ambiguous meaning to the respondent. So what? How you can overcome this? You can design or you can divide this separate features into separate portions. Very well, it is tasty. Maybe yes and no. And subsequently, the dairy milk is refreshing. And yes and no. And yes to only take one appropriate call. So content means, the content of the question should be clear, objective, and don't try to combine too many aspects or too many questions into a single question. If you are intended to ask different values, different aspects to the customer, then it's better to ask separate questions for each attribute or each characteristic of the product. Similarly, to avoid, to minimize this space, you can ask your perception about the dairy milk. Then you can list the attributes like taste, refreshing, pleasant, enjoyable, all these things, and then subsequently ask. Make a column of yes and no, or make a Likert scale, like strongly agree to strongly disagree, whatever scale you want. So that will be a better design. Next, when we come to the inability of the respondent, how to overcome this inability. So before overcoming the inability, we have to first understand what is inability itself. Why the respondent is unable to answer your queries. Now the respondent may be unable to answer your queries if the respondent is not know about the subject, or maybe not informed about the subject or your object. Suppose your objective is to conduct satisfaction about the mobile banking services, and you ask a respondent about mobile banking services or satisfaction or perception about mobile banking services, and the respondent haven't used a single transaction through his mobile phones. So the respondent don't know about mobile phones, mobile phone transactions, mobile phone payments. So he or she is not able to respond to that particular questionnaire or respond to particular questions. It means the respondent is not able to answer. So if the respondent is not able to answer, if you are forcing that respondent to answer, then it may be possible it gives a biased answer or wrong responses to you. And that can create a later disadvantages in data analysis and drawbacks in the data analysis and give wrong results. So what does it imply? That if you overcome the inability, first, it's better to know whether the respondent or the person is known to your objective, is able, is aware about your objective, is educated about what the scenario you are presenting or what the basic requirement of your asking the question and taking the information. So how you can do it? It's very simple. There is one technique called filter question. Filter question means a single statement question or a single question which create a filter between a known respondent or informed respondent and to an unknown respondent or non-informed respondent. For example, in the last case, if we want to ask customer satisfaction about mobile banking services, the filter question can be at the initial level of the questionnaire, that whether you use mobile for banking transactions or not. Yes and no. Now this type of question, what will it do? This type of question will filter the respondent, whether the respondent is qualified to respond or not. If I have never used mobile phone for banking transactions or for any bill payment or utility payments, if I say no, then the further question will not be displayed and the questionnaire or the interaction will drop. It saves the time first, and then save the respondent, researcher time and respondent time. It also save the effort. It also save the entry of or the chances of the errors in the responses and then later on in the data analysis part. So it's better to ask the respondent whether the he or she is able to understand the problem, he or she is able to respond to that particular problem or particular area, if it, they are aware about that particular issue or not. So that is how you can overcome that inability. If the issue is not very critical or technical, you can always give a certain background information in the front page or in the uppermost paragraph of the questionnaire to get some background information. And then if the respondent feel okay, if now I know the subject or now I know the scenario, then I can respond, then you can go on. Second thing is, suppose I ask the respondent that what were the items you last purchased when you visit to suppose a big bazaar. And a big bazaar is a grocery store or retail store, or you can say a shopping mall or mall outlet. And you are trying to make the respondent or try to forcing the respondent to remember those items which they have purchased in their last visit to shopping in big bazaar. Now what is the flaw or what is the drawback in this question itself? It creates a pressure of remembering the last visit as well as the tentative time of the visit as well as the items I have purchased as a respondent I have purchased from Big Bazaar. If my last visit to Big Bazaar is about suppose 2 months back, and then it's very difficult to remember me what I have purchased 2 months back from that Big Bazaar. So the next problem is whether the respondent is able to remember or not. So it's better not to ask those questions which require a central mental effort for the respondent to think for very past transactions. Now if it is necessary for your questionnaire or for your objective to ask those items purchased from particular grocery store or big bazaar, then it's better that you design a questionnaire in a manner which gives a provide hint to that respondent. For example, suppose if I am asking that same question to the respondent that what are the items you have purchased from your last visit from the big bazaar, then I can list out certain items, suppose shoes, apparels, then fashions, then grocery, then electronic, then mobile devices, then deodorant and all these things, and then make a list of those items, and this list can provide as a hint to the respondent to respond to that particular thing. So that is how you can overcome that possibility of recalling those past transactions. But it has been said that don't ask those questions which create a mental pressure to the respondent to remember the last past transactions. So many last past transactions. The third thing is, suppose I ask question which include a imaginary part or include an effort to imagine a scenario. Suppose I ask a question that what will happen if you were in a shopping mall and there is a blackout there. What will happen if you search for an item in a shopping mall or in a retail environment and you don't find it. So these types of questions create a pressure of imagination to the respondent. Articulation you can mean. So if the question required articulation and if you feel that the respondent is not able to articulate, or this question will require a more qualified respondent who can articulate the situation or imagine the situation or the surroundings and then respond, don't ask those questions. So it may, if you ask those questions, it may come across that the respondent will not answer. Respondent will not enable to answer. So basically we have three issues with inability of the answering the questions. If the respondent is not known about the subject, if the respondent is not able to remember about the past transactions or the certain things which you are asking, and if the respondent is not able to imagine or articulate the situation which you are asking. So how to overcome this? Provide the background information, it's better. Provide the background information before asking the conducting the questionnaire. Don't ask so much questions which require more articulation and imaginary situations. And then you can provide some hints, answer or hint to the question itself to better recall the situation. Next thing is unwillingness. Unwillingness generally arises when your questionnaire is dull. Now what does it mean by dull? It means that the questionnaire is not able to attract the customer, attract the respondent. It may lack the bright colors. If the respondents are below 15 age or you are try to collect information from children, they try to play with colors. So if you go with a plain black and white paper, and then so it may possible that the respondent or the child will not respond. So it depends on the respondent if what she or she like colors or not. You can play with cartoons, you can play with fancy designs, you can play with certain graphics in the questionnaire. So to remove this dullness, you can use pictures, you can use cartoons. Now if you are asking towards a more qualified respondent or towards a more literate respondent, and your questionnaire is asking about some statistical data or some past figures and follow, it's better to present your background information in the form of chart or graphs with certain text. Also, your text should contain some certain figures. Suppose you are conducting a survey, a market survey, through a marketer or through a businessman, it's better to give a paragraph writing about the market scenario that this much. Suppose you are asking, conducting a survey for automobile industry in to automobile marketers, then it's better to give a certain line of background which say that the automobile industry will grow by X percentage in 2016 or this percentage in 2015. Then this $1 million market in this. So this ask, you can include some figures also. You can include some graphs and charts also to make it more fancy or more representative to the respondent or to the business person. And then you can ask their opinion about the scenario. Okay. So it's better to present graphs or charts. You can also remove the dullness by improving your paper quality. So don't use so much light paper. It should have use some thick paper. Use some, if your budget allows, then you can use some glossy paper. You can use colored printouts, multiple colored printouts. So the paper quality and colors also you can remove dullness. So through that, all these things, you can also motivate this user to respond. What we are trying to do is to remove that unwillingness of the respondent to respond. Another thing which is related to unwillingness is if you ask sensitive information. If you ask sensitive information from me, I may not be able to respond. The sensitive information or sensitive areas may include, if you are asking for a professional, may include their income levels. It may include their family background, asking about their family background, asking about their marital status, asking about their, you can say, past relationships, asking about their caste detail, religion detail specifically. So don't ask sensitive information or the information which can create an unwillingness until it is until and unless it is required or basic objective of your research. So don't ask those questions. So that is a basic tool you can use to remove this unwillingness. Another method of removing this obstacle, that if you want to ask some sensitive questions or some if the question is required, then you can put it at the end of the questionnaire. So the first part of the questionnaire, initial parts of the questionnaire will include the question which ask about his perception or attitude or satisfaction or whatever you want, and then the last part of the section will include that demographic details. Okay, like gender, age, income, family status, marital status and all that. So the next part, so what it will help? It will help to direct rejection of the questionnaire from the respondent. So if you ask sensitive question in the first part, it may happen that the respondent will not respond and then return the questionnaire to you. And if you ask that information at the last, the certain data which you want will be available to you. Okay. And the last part is optional. Another thing is that first you give background information, it's always better. Always give a better background information or prior information about what is your objective. So your background information is generally you are clearing your objective. So your objective should be clear. Suppose you are a restaurant owner, and after taking dinner by the customer, you try to fill a questionnaire which ask about the quality of the services, quality of the food, and the quality of the environment of your restaurant before educating the customer about your research objective. So if you do that, it may be possible the respondent will not respond to the questionnaire. So what you will do, you just before asking those questions, you can create a background information and educate the customer that this exercise will I want to conduct some questionnaire, some survey from you, ask some questions from you. This will help us to improve our services, and this will help us to improve our drawbacks. So kindly help us. Then it may be possible that the respondent is willing to answer. Okay. So your objective should be clear at the first. The first part of the questionnaire or the top part of the questionnaire will be clearly state your objective. What your objective of this filling out the respondent information or getting the respondent information, and how this information will help the your business or the society at large. So this will create a motivation to the respondent to respond. And the last part is structure. So in the structure part, what things you have to remember? Suppose in the structure means if you ask a question which require a certain hints from the question itself, then don't ask a direct question to them. If it is an open-ended question, there are certainly two types of questions which we all know, that is open-ended and closed-ended. Closed-ended gives some set of alternatives to choose. And open-ended doesn't give certain alternatives, you have to write your in your own ways or your own language or your own responses to it. Okay, so the blank space will be provided. So if suppose I want to ask customer satisfaction or perception about certain product or certain soap or shampoo or any FMCG product, it's better to give options. Okay. So close-ended question is very much preferred by the respondent to respond, because he or she has to primarily only tick or select the following one of the following responses, rather than writing a paragraph or writing few words is very difficult for the respondent. It's very time consuming and efforts also is required. So the structure means when you ask a question, then you decide then what kind of structure I want to follow, whether this question will be an open ended question, or if you want some suggestions, the comment from the respondent, then certainly you can go with an open-ended question. But if you ask what a certain response is to be categorized, then kindly go for this closed-ended question. So structure will decide how you go for the question. So these are some issues which will be keep in mind before circulating the questionnaire, because ultimate objective of questionnaire is to motivate the respondent to respond and to get the right information from the respondent. Okay, so it's better to avoid the inability of the respondent, to overcome the inability of the respondent, to educate them, to motivate them, so that they can respond to the desired object, to fulfill your desired object. Now we will certainly fastly go through that slides I have. So in this we can see questionnaire design. So question is a set of questions. It's translate your information needs into certain specific questions of the respondent that will answer. And here you can see that the objective is to that uplift, motivate and encourage the respondent to respond. This we have already discussed what are the different steps. First you identify the information need, then content of the individual questions, then inability to answer, then decide on the structure, then wording and then layout and all this. There are three basic types: mail questionnaires, telephonic questionnaires, personal questionnaires. This is how you decide basically information content. Suppose in this question you are asking, do you think Coca-Cola is tasty and refreshing? So you are combining two things into one question, so it is incorrect. Try to make different statements and capture different responses and for different questions. And it is always better that don't force the respondent to remember. Suppose you are asking how many grams of soft drinks did you consume in the last 4 years. It's very difficult for the respondent to remember how many gallons and how many liters of soft drinks I have drank. So it's better to give options in a range of. So I've already discussed that it's better to this filter question. It will filter the respondent whether the given respondent is educated or informed about this or know about the scenario which you are asking. If the respondent is unable to articulate or imagine, then don't ask those questions. You can overcome some kind of this limitation by giving some pictures, giving some maps or some description. But personally, I suggest that don't ask those imaginary questions. To describe an environment or imagine for an environment or imagine for a scenario, if you are doing that, if you are doing that. So don't ask those questions. It will create a mental pressure to the respondent and may result in wrong descriptions. These are about unwillingness, how to overcome those unwillingness. Similarly, unwillingness, if you ask certain questions which require more mental effort, it will refuse to answer, then it's better to ask, put some options and then he has to or she has to take from the given response. Put sensitive topics at the last of the questionnaire. Then you can also give some certain figures, as we have discussed, certain figures, certain charts, graphs or certain statistics figures from the market survey to motivate the respondent to respond or to know about what is the scenario and what are your objectives. This is about structure, how you structure the question. There are two basic ways: unstructured question means like open-ended questions, and structured question are generally closed-ended questions. So suppose here we can give example that if you want to ask that do you intend to buy a new car within the next 6 months, it is a question which require which can result to a answer which is not in the form of structured. So it's better to ask an closed-ended question or a structured question. Structured question can be a multiple choice. Same question can be described like this. That do you intend to buy an anchor within next month? Okay, definitely will not buy, probably will not buy, undecided, probably will buy, or definitely not will buy. So the respondent has to take only one of them. So it is, you can precisely measure the perception or precisely measure the thoughts of the respondent. This is about simple and multiple choice design. One more design can be, you can certainly ask yes, no, don't know for the same question. You can also use a Likert scale. So same question can be described or can be captured through a Likert scale from definitely not, will not buy to definitely will buy, and certain in between scales. Wording is also important. Suppose in this case, which brand of shampoo do you use? This is incorrect because it is not specifying what you are specifically asking. So it's better to specify that which brand of shampoo have you personally used at home. That's not describing the place. You have to describe the place. It's not describing what is the purpose. Here you describe the purpose. It's not describing the brand. Here you describe the brand. So it's better to describe what precisely what you want. What on the what criteria you want the answer. So this is the right question, that which brand of shampoo have you personally used. So this is personally, that is a specific objective. This is the place, home, during the last month. This is the time period. In case of more than one brand, please indicate. So good questions will have include this two part, this 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 W's: who, what, when, and where. So certain in the last case, where is home, when means the last month, what is the brand of the shampoo, and who, that is the respondent itself, you personally use. The personally means that who is using that word. Don't use unambiguous words. Now, ambiguous means it is typically a month. Suppose for in a typical month, how often do you shop in a departmental store? Now, this is ambiguous. Why? Because never, occasionally, sometime, often, regularly can be different to different person. If I shop 2 times in a month, for me it is occasionally. For you, it can be often. So it is not decide, don't make the respondent to decide whether their shopping frequency is occasionally, can be categorized as occasionally, frequently, or never, or regularly. Try to quantify those into numbers. So if you quantify those numbers, then the respondent is easily able to remember, okay, last month I shop 3 times in a month. Okay, so this is my response. And then later on the data came, then you can categorize that responses into whether that 3 to 4 according to you is regularly or occasionally. So don't force the respondent to give their own mental categories. You can only, it's better to give the numerical values or numerical categories to respond. So it's better to remember and easy to convert this data into categories. Ordering of the question, first, as I already discussed, the questionnaire should have an opening question or a description about the objective. That is an opening part. Second, the next will be classify what type of information you will ask. And then subsequently, some more difficult question if you want, then it will be the next subsequent part of the question. And the last part will be the sensitive questions. So it's better to design a questionnaire into several parts, several sections. Every question should be numbered, pre-coded. So this is some how you can decide. You specify the categories itself. pre-testing of questionnaire, you can always pre-test. Suppose your sample size is so large, suppose you want to conduct a survey about 3000 people, and it's better to, before circulating to the 3000 people, questionnaire is better to pre-test that questionnaire through a small sample, but that what we call is a pilot study. So you can conduct take a sample of 30 people or 40 respondents, and then try to interview them personally, try to get the time, what time the respondent is able to respond. You can also take out the difficult wording if the certain respondent are not able to understand the meaning of certain words. So you can take out that wording part. So try to remove that difficult word with the simple English words. Then you can also come about the ambiguity in the questions. If you are asking the same thing to multiple locations or through multiple questions, so you can create that repetition. If you are asking confusing thing which the respondent is not able to take out the correct answer, then you can remove that ambiguity part. So that includes the pre-testing part. So it is advisable that if you are serving for a large sample, then you can divide that sample into a certain pilot sample of 30, of certain, suppose 10% of the large sample, of the total sample size, and then try to pre-test that questionnaire for this, the timing, wording, ambiguous questions, layout, and all this. So this is all about questionnaire designing and form layout, and the next section we will come to the sampling. Thank you.